In 1957, moviegoers at the Polk Theater in Lakeland, Florida, didn't know what to make of the overly dressed white-haired man commanding the aisle, using his cane to point out the horrible attributes of the building's architecture. If they expected him to stop talking when the first reel of the Ten Commandments unspooled, they were mistaken. Once seated, he continued to loudly criticize the film's direction and sets. His lone praise, save for the actress portraying Nefertiti. "You get him, Annie," he shouted to the Academy Award-winning star of The Razor's Edge and All About Eve, who was now chewing scenery in DeMille's blockbuster. The man was architect Frank Lloyd Wright. And that actress? His granddaughter, Anne Baxter. Born in 1923 to Wright's daughter, Catherine, young Annie was fond of her grandfather, and he was an ardent supporter of her work. But Wright's flirtations with Hollywood started years before Annie's turn in the spotlight. In the late teens, following a decade of scandal, Wright was commissioned to create the massive Imperial Hotel in Tokyo, while also juggling a multi-building project for arts maven Aline Barnstill in Los Angeles. Sadly, the needs of the sprawling hotel project and the length of Pacific travel made communication with the mercurial Barnstill difficult, and the arts campus was scuttled as just three buildings neared completion. But Wright didn't let this sour ending spoil his plans to restart his career in Hollywood, and he doubled down on a new textile block construction system to make his mark in an environment very different from his native Wisconsin. Built between 1923 and 1925, Wright's three California textile block homes ranged from the compact, the Freeman House, to soaring and palatial. Built for a successful retailer, the enormous Ennis House competes with both the Hollywood sign and the Griffith Observatory for prominence on the Hollywood Hills. Like the smaller textile houses, Ennis is constructed from blocks mixed and poured on site, creating a woven structure throughout the home. While Frank Lloyd Wright's attempt to set up a new practice in Hollywood had been thwarted, his son, who he had tasked with managing the textile block sites, did find the success that eluded the elder Wright, going on to create memorable Southern California projects, including the glass-walled and glass-roofed Wayfarers Chapel, additions to the Hollywood Bowl, and several notable homes, including the stunning Samuel Navarro House. The Samuel Navarro House had been home to a number of Hollywood elite, including actress Diane Keaton. Lloyd Wright, who had dropped the Frank and Junior from his name, possibly to gain distance from his father's tumultuous past, also designed the Soden House, home to Dr. Hodel, a man accused by his own son of being the Black Dahlia murderer. Hollywood would come calling again two decades later. Author Ayn Rand, eager to hear Wright's thoughts on a new project, unsuccessfully reached out to him for an interview. It was only after her novel about a unique architect, The Fountainhead, was published, did Wright invite Rand to his Plaza suite to, quote, share everything you've gotten wrong in your book. Undeterred by his rudeness, Rand engaged Wright to not only design an unrealized home for her, but also to craft the building designs for the Hollywood film version of her book. But Wright's proposed fee, which he insisted should equal his standard contract of 10% of an overall project's budget, proved too costly, so the film designers tried approximating a Wright design with some questionable results. Wright was again lured to Hollywood by Huntington Hartford, heir to the A&P grocery fortune. Wright's proposed country club would rise out of LA's Runyon Canyon like a squadron of flying saucers seeking low orbit. The troubled project never materialized, and Hartford took his money to the Bahamas, turning Pig Island into paradise, now home to the Atlantis Resort. The next to unsuccessfully call Wright to Hollywood was producer Mike Todd, who had been instrumental in CinemaScope and later developed a single-lens large-format film method called the Todd AO process. He chose Wright to design precast concrete domes to house his theaters. Sadly, both the theaters and the process failed after Todd's death in a plane crash. Now busy with plans for the Guggenheim Museum, Wright returned to New York, but Hollywood followed. Newlyweds Marilyn Monroe and Arthur Miller visited Wright at the Plaza to inquire about a small, quiet country home. Miller recalled hiking to the top of the Hilled, Connecticut property with Wright, marveling that this man twice his age had little use for his cane and wasn't even winded when the pair reached the summit. Unfortunately, Wright either misunderstood their requests or believed he could convince them to construct something grander because the small, quiet plans he produced included a 40-foot-wide circular glass-domed living room and a dining room that seated about 12 in its smallest configuration. Wright's plans were set aside and the pair moved along, eventually divorcing a short time later. While Wright never worked in films, Hollywood was eager for his unique designs. The 1959 movie, A Summer Place, utilized exteriors of Wright's magnificent Walker House in Carmel, California. The small size of the home didn't fit the movie's needs, so the studio designers utilized the iconic window form in a much larger set created on a soundstage. For the film North by Northwest, Alfred Hitchcock reportedly wanted a Frank Lloyd Wright type design for the villain's lair at the top of Mount Rushmore, which may explain the cantilever plan eventually created for the film. But even as a set, the design proved costly, leading the creative team to render the full house as a matte painting, building just a portion of the house for actual human interactions. Wright's influence on Hollywood continued into the 70s and beyond, often used for futuristic settings. George Lucas featured the Marin County Civic Center in his 1971 film THX 1138, while producers in the 90s would make the complex the centerpiece of the sci-fi film Gattaca, starring Ethan Hawke and Uma Thurman. The Ennis House, with its thousands of textile blocks, has been used as past, present, and future settings in films like The House on Haunted Hill, Karate Kid 3, and Blade Runner. Castings of the blocks have popped up as wall textures in various television productions, while other textile block designs have inspired set pieces on shows like Star Trek and Game of Thrones. And due to its proximity to major film studios and its grand setting in the Hollywood Hills, the Ennis House even featured heavily in the plotline of Disney's The Rocketeer, serving as the headquarters of a 1930s villain played by Timothy Dalton. And even Wright's work outside of California has gotten the Hollywood treatment, with the Annie Pfeiffer Chapel at Florida Southern College getting a makeover to host a futuristic episode of NBC's 90s series, Sequest DSV. Incidentally, Wright was to have given a speech at Florida Southern College in 1957, when after a long, winding introduction, he abruptly excused himself, leaving a stunned crowd to eat dinner in silence while he loudly cheered on his granddaughter at the Polk Theater in a little film called The Ten Commandments. Thank you.